As already said, my name is Johannes. I'm a web developer since 2006. I'm mainly working with PHP as a backend developer right now, but I'm also doing stuff in Golang. And in the past, I've already done stuff with .NET and Java, so I have a broad experience with different languages. And currently, I'm working as a lead web developer at Karriere.at. My current employer, Karriere.at, is the biggest job platform in Austria. We are about 150 people there, and about 40 of them are working in a development-related field, so project managers, designers, and even developers. So today, I would like to talk about OAuth2. So when I started to look into this topic, it was some kind of magic for me. I include this link on my website, and when you press the button, log in with Facebook, for example, Facebook does all the authentication and authorization stuff for you, and then you get back an access token, and you make sure that the current user is logged in into your application. So, let's wait a minute. Yeah, maybe the biggest joke about OAuth2 was that my boss
walks into a bar.
Whoa. And my boss came to me and told me about an upcoming project, and he told we should go with OAuth2 to implement the authorization stuff on our side. So he told me, look into it, we need this in 1 week. So I had hard times back then because I have absolutely no clue about OAuth2 and at that point of time, and it was really hard because there is actually no really good documentation out there. There's this RFC stuff and kind of these things, and they are not human readable, at least for me, in my opinion.
Okay, next slide.
Yeah, two or three. Next one. So why OAuth2? I've already told a bit about the story. Back then, we had two main applications out on the internet. This was on the one hand side, the B2C application for our users to search for new job offers and to apply to a certain job offer. Next slide, please. And on the other hand, there was the B2B application for our customers that allows them to manage their job offers, talk to talents, and interconnect with them. And these two logins were against our central API. And this API was broken up in two parts. On one hand, there was this auth API handling all this login stuff and credentials checking. And on the other hand, we had this resource APIs that were responsible for doing all the CRUD stuff, to deliver data to our client applications, and this was only possible with the tokens issued with the, from the auth API. And about 1.5 years ago, we bought another company, and we got another application in our portfolio. This was a recruiter app, and we wanted to include this application into our login flow. It was basically the B2B login, but with some additional flags if the customer is allowed to access and so kind of stuff. And a good solution for multiple logins to centralize is to use a well-known standard, and so we decided to go with OAuth2. When we think about OAuth2, I think almost every developer has come in touch with OAuth 2 when it comes to social login. This is mit Facebook anmelden, mit Google anmelden, this kind of stuff where you leave up the authorization and authentication part to a provider that is not known to you. So the complete password checking and stuff like that is done on their side. And you get back the token and you can validate that the user is logged in at the moment. But social login shows one of the big problems with OAuth 2 because it's not really a specification. It was transferred into a framework. And a framework is nothing that is very explicit about points. And this slide shows this very good because when you look at the five main gateways, Facebook, GitHub, Google, and so on, you need a specific implementation for each of them. They were not able to make a common subset of functions that work on all platforms to have only one provider for the identity management. And on the right-hand side, there's a lot of other third-party implementations that are needed to actually get OAuth 2 working with their platforms. So when we would like to look into OAuth, we need to define a whole bunch of terms. And these are the terms for my talk today. We will talk about roles, clients, tokens, and token management, token validation, then user identity to know who is the actual user that this access token was granted for, the different grant types that OAuth 2 implements, and also a bit piece of implementation details, how you can implement an OAuth 2 server on your side. So let's begin with the definitions. OAuth 2 defines four roles. Basically, you have the resource owner. This is the user that is actually using your client application and that grants access to his sensitive data. Then you have a resource server that is able to deliver this sensitive data from a user and it is necessary on the resource server to check these access tokens if they are valid. Then the client, this is a somehow difficult term in respect to OAuth 2 because the client is the application that is using OAuth 2 and not the client that's sitting behind the computer. That's very important. And the last role is the authorization server that is handling the complete credential checking, token management, and this kind of stuff. When we talk about clients, to get OAuth 2 working for a client application, we need some sort of information in our code. This is at first the client identifier and a client secret that is necessary for exchanging this data with an access token. Then you need to define this redirect URL because at the end of the OAuth grant flow, you will get the redirect back to your client application, and this needs to be set up as explicit as possible. You can define a domain, but then you can, when somebody gets into the control flow, he can redirect to any URL on your domain, and that's not a very good implementation detail. So, and also another important point is you need to be explicit about the grant types that the client is allowed to use. Okay, so we have now defined the first parts of OAuth 2. Now let's look into tokens. The specification only tells you that you should use a signature-based token, but no really implementation detail. And there's one de facto standard out there that's the JSON Web Token or called JOT. It's an open standard for securely transmitting data. It's compact and self-contained. This means that every information to validate and extract data from the token is contained in the token itself. And it's mainly used for authentication purposes and for information exchange between two parties. Now, when we dig into this JOT token, the first part is the JOT header. A JOT header tells you information about the token itself. It's, of course, a JOT token. The algorithm used was RS-256, and you have a unique identifier for this token. Then inside of the JOT payload, the next part of the JOT token, you have the information about the client this token was issued for, the unique identifier again, then timestamps when the token was issued, when it can be used, and also when it is expiring. Then you have an identifier for the subject, for the user, the resource owner that this token was granted for, and also the scopes that the resource server can check against and do some kind of permission handling. Then the last part of the JOT token is the so-called signature. This is basically only the header and payload information, base64 decoded, concatenated with a dot, and then some crypto magic on top of this, and then you get this complete JOT token. Next. This is a wonderful JWT token, as it is written out completely. But there's also a problem with it. Because these parts are Base64 encoded, everybody can decode it. So you must be very, very sure what you are stuffing into the token, because when you are hiding sensitive data in it, possibly everybody that has access to this token can read this information out. So we have the roles defined, we have talked about clients, we have talked about tokens. So now let's start with the most popular grant type in OAuth2, that's the ALF code grant. When we take a look at the bigger picture, then we see three parties involved, a browser, a client application, and the authorization server. And at first, the browser, the user, makes a request to the client application and gets some sort of HTML output. Then he clicks on the login button and starts the login request against the authorization server. The authorization server doesn't know anything about the user, so he sends back a login page. The user enters his username and his password, sends back to the server, and now the auth server can validate his credentials on its own, or he can use an identity provider back to validate it, and then complete the authorize step, send back a redirect to the client application with the authorization code attached, and the browser then follows this redirect. And in the backend communication channel, this is not interceptable by the client or the browser application. The client application can make a post request against the authorization server with the auth code from the URL. And this information is enough to validate on the auth server that this is a good request, this is from the same client application, and an access token is returned. And from now on, the client application knows, OK, the user has granted access, and he is locked in from now on. So let's dig a little bit deeper into this flow. The first step is, of course, a login button. It's login with karriere.at. You click on it, and a request to the authorize endpoint on the authorization server is triggered. You tell the authorization server you want a response type of code, because we are in the auth code grant. You tell the server that the client ID is my actual client ID. Then the scopes you want to access, or you want to have privilege for, and also a state parameter that's some sort of CSRF token, because you want to make sure that nobody in this whole authorization flow can start a man-in-the-middle attack and intercept and manipulate data from the request. OK, next step is the authorization server has no information about the user, so he sends back a redirect to the login form. Then the wonderful login form is displayed. Username and password are entered, the login button is clicked, and the data is pushed back to the server. Now the authorization server validates these credentials, and when everything is fine, he sends back and redirect to the browser with the callback URL for the client defined, and also with the authorization code attached, and also the state parameter from the first, from the initial request. So the client application can now validate the state, so that everything was fine in between, and then can use the code parameter to actually exchange this parameter against an access token. This is done with a post request in the backend channel, so this is nothing visible to the browser. And here you have to also pass on the client secret and the authorization code. And when everything is fine, you get back the auth code, the access token response. This tells you that this a token type is a bearer token, then time span when the token will expire, and of course the access token, the actual JWT token to be used for accessing other APIs. The refresh token I will skip for now. I will talk about that a bit later. So the next important thing is, because we have now a successful login, we would like to have information about the user, so we like to identify him. The first solution that comes in mind would be a profile endpoint on our resource server, where we send our access token against, and then the resource server can tell us that is a John Doe with his profile picture and his email address. But that's an additional request on every login, and that's not cool, because it's an additional round trip and it takes time. So there is another standard called OpenID Connect. That's an identity layer on top of OAuth2. And it's basically requested in the authorize step with the OpenID scope. It's an additional scope that you append to the initial URL. And then you get an ID token delivered with the token response. It's only an additional field in your JSON response. And you can take the JWT token, load the claims out of it, and you have the same information as before from the resource server. Okay, now we know everything about the user. Now we want to step further, and we want to validate our tokens. First thing that comes in mind, we would like to do this on the client. But that's not a good idea, because the client only should hold the token in the session and use it for API calls and not do or extract data out of the token. You are allowed to use the expires field from the token response to have some sort of clue when the token maybe will expire, but the rest should be left up to the resource or to the authorization server. On the resource server, you can look into the JWT token, check the expiration date, do signature verification. But signature verification has a lot of downsides. The resource server needs to know the public key from your crypto magic, because private public key, you have to distribute the public key over all your APIs. And this is an additional step, and it's hard to maintain, I think. And also, validation on the resource server has the problem that token revocation, for example, when a client gets compromised, you want to revoke all tokens issued for the client, and this is not possible on the resource server because the connection to the authorization server is missing, so he cannot check is the token revoked or not. Okay, for this is another solution on top of OAuth 2. It's called token introspection. It's basically another endpoint, a post endpoint on the authorization server, and you provide the token to the post request, and it provides the complete payload of the JWT token, and also if the token is valid or not. So for an invalid token, you get a JSON response with active false, and for a valid token, active true, and all the payload information human readable in a JSON document. So now let's have a short demo. Hopefully the video is working. We have a wonderful login page. We have this button. When we hover over the button, we can see that this is the first request, the authorized request with all of these parameters as shown before. And when we click on the button, hopefully it's happening fast enough, we can see that the authorized endpoint responded with a redirect, and the browser is loading the login form. Now the user can enter his login credentials, and when he sends back the form to the server will immediately respond with another redirect to the callback URL, because John Doe and the password is were fine. And you can see the callback URL contains this big code parameter attached, and this code parameter can be used by the client application to exchange against an access token. On the left-hand side, we can see the token header and the token payload extracted from the JWT token. And also on the top, we have the expires information. This is the information that the client should use, and the header and payload information should be skipped in the client. Okay, now let's look at token introspection. We send the token to the authorization server and get back this JSON response. It tells us the token is active, and you can see the subject is John Doe, so this is issued for me. Perfect. Okay, we have looked at the authorization code grant now, but there are also other grant types. The first one that comes in mind is the implicit grant. It's a simplified form of the authorization code grant, but instead of an authorization code, directly the access token gets returned to the callback URL, and this is kind of weird and kind of dangerous, so it's not recommended anymore. It was mainly used as an upgrade path from OAuth 1, and you should use the auth code grant instead. The next grant type is password grant, where you use your username and password in a client form and attach the client credentials, the identifier, and the secret to the request, and exchange this information against an access token directly without redirect magic and so stuff. But this is only should only be used in your private network for first-party applications, because it's not a very secure way to authenticate and authorize. Then there's also a grant type called client credentials grant, where you exchange a client ID and a secret without user information against an access token. This is used for machine-to-machine communication when you have cron jobs or system tasks that talk to the resource APIs. And the last grant type is the refresh token grant. As we've seen before, our token response contained a refresh token, and now the client can use this refresh token to exchange it against the new access token and refresh token pair when the actual access token has expired. Yeah, now, which grant type should I use in which use case? Yeah, of code flow, of course, for any type of third-party application, for SPAs and for native apps. One short information about SPAs. It's not a good idea to include the client secret in your JavaScript bundle because almost everybody can read this information. But there's another setup on OAuth2. It's called Proof Key for Code Exchange, where you build up a login challenge on the client, start the whole authorization code flow, and in the last step, when you exchange the authorization code against an access token, you send also the secret that was used for generating the login challenge to the authorization server, and so the authorization server can make sure that the request was started by the client and also the access token request was done by the same client. Okay, the other ones, maybe we step back. The first password grant is, of course, for first-party applications, for internal tools that do not connect to the outside world, client credentials for cron jobs and system tasks, and implicit grant shouldn't be used. Okay. Now, when we come to implementing an OAuth2 server, we have some options and some use cases. The first one that comes in mind is a cloud service. So someone else is responsible for implementing and managing this whole authorization stuff for you. It's easy to use and easy to implement in my client application because every cloud service provider has its SDKs for different languages, and I simply stuff some configuration in it, and everything is working out fine. But the cloud service has also some downsides. At first, you need to transfer your whole user base, your whole user data to the cloud, which is often problematic. And also, the complete authorization and authentication procedure is outsourced, so you can't make custom adoptions when you need additional flags or checks. This is not possible with cloud services at all. The second solution would be to use a framework in the language of your choice to implement a complete OAuth server on your side. There's for PHP the OAuth server package by the PHP League, Node.js, Node OAuth server by OAuth.js, and in Java, of course, there's an addition to Spring Security called OAuth2. But there's also a third option that Sebastian brought up in a Slack chat recently. You can use on-premise services. They provide you with the complete OAuth2 implementation. This is basically a binary that you start up on your production environment. And this implementation allows you to integrate your custom login provider, your custom consent provider, and the whole of OAuth2 stuff is handled by the binary, by the application, and only for login and scope grants, your custom code is called. One example of such a system would be Ori.sh. This is a startup from Munich, so it's really popular right now, and if you want to implement your own OAuth2 solution, you should have definitely a look into it. So, this was my information about OAuth2. Let's summarize up what we have heard. OAuth2 is a great standard for implementing an authorization system. It has many different grant types for different use cases, but it needs to be combined with an authentication mechanism. OAuth2 is very explicit about the authorization stuff, but authentication is left out completely. You have to do this on your own. And as already said, OAuth2 is not a specification, really. It's more a framework. It has very squishy and not complete boundaries, so you need to be very explicit about your implementation. I've read a blog post from one of the core writers of the initial OAuth2 specification, and he told that OAuth2 is not secure at all. At least if you are an security expert and you know really what you're doing and you have deep knowledge in each of the fields that I've shown you now, you can make a secure system, but out of the box, it's not. Yeah, and the last cool thing about OAuth2 is it can help you to centralize your authentication and authorization system in your organization. You have this one endpoint where you make all your login calls against, and the stuff is not distributed over your client applications. So now some resources where you can find information about OAuth2. The first one is a listing of all RFCs relevant for OAuth2, but of course I've said they are not human readable or very difficult to understand. So there's also the website OAuth.com, which has a very easy writing about OAuth2, and you can get lots of information from there. And if you're a book lover, you can also buy OAuth2 in Action by Justin Richer and Antonio Sanso. It's a good book. Justin Richer was also in the core committee of the specification, and he has very deep knowledge about OAuth2. So my slides are already up on SpeakerDeck, and you also find the demo application that was shown in the video before on GitHub. It has the client and the authorization server in it, so you can dig into it, play around, and maybe pick out some good parts for your application. Okay, thanks a lot. Thanks for having me. Have a nice day.
Thank you, Johannes.